I'm Katie, aka Michelle.
I'm Nancy. I'm in sixth semester, Katie's in seventh, and Walter's in fifth. And this past break, we went on a conservation medicine externship with Wildlife Vet South Africa, and it was awesome. So we want to tell you guys about it.
So what did we do? Our days were like jam-packed with activities, lectures. We did drug research trials, captures and relocations. We did snake and crocodile handling and veterinary care. We visited several rehab centers, Kruger National Park, and we did some work in the community, but mostly we had a lot of fun. Our days often started really early in the morning, and we would go and do lectures or go out into the community and do different things, and then it would end with like a lot of delicious food and drinks and a beautiful African sunset.
So one of the days we got to practice using the different types of dart guns. We did like the firearms, like actual firearms, and then like the pressurized like air cannon dart guns. So we got to like see the difference between those, and then we had a shooting competition at the end, and I think like someone won a free t-shirt or something. We had like a dart board a couple meters away, and whoever got the closest to the center won. But Garen, he's JP's son, who took over the business after JP retired, but he kind of sat us down, you know, before we got into, you know, firearm safety and all that. He took the time to kind of go over conservation medicine in South Africa and like the whole hunting situation. I know that's been a big thing this past week with some new U.S. Laws, but potential laws. Yes. So you know, I definitely went there with an opinion, and after that talk with Garen, it definitely changed my opinion. You know, still I don't think anyone besides an elephant should have ivory, but South Africa is very corrupt. The government is, you know, if you think America's bad, South Africa, you know, isn't that much better. It's very corrupt. So, you know, their hunting laws is the best way that they can provide conservation to these animals right now. So it may not be the best option, but it's the only way that's working. But again, you know, if you get the opportunity to go, you can definitely feel more educated on the situation regardless of your opinion. So I really like that portion.
So for another 2 days of our 2 week externship, we did drug research trials, and this is actually the main like bread and butter of the company. Without doing these drug research trials to help fund the pharmaceutical aspect of things, they wouldn't have nearly enough of the finances that they do in order to help with the conservation that they do. So what we did is on two different days, we tested different anesthetics in Westbrook, which is the picture, a little guy on the bottom. And while they were under anesthesia, we got a lot of just veterinary experience doing general anesthesia monitoring, such as taking blood samples, pulse oximetry, temperature, arterial samples to, you know, go over their acid-base status, and ultrasound for pregnancy checks. So it was a great overall, just like basic veterinary care. Practice.
Another day, we got to go to the snake venom facility where they collect different snake venoms and like create anti-serum and all that stuff. We got to learn. The beginning was a couple lectures on like basic handling and husbandry of snakes and reptiles. Then we got to tour the snake venom facility. We got to see a whole bunch of different types of snakes. We saw black mambas, green mambas, Jameson mambas. It's like a mixture. It's like half black, half green. It's really weird. Kind of cool. Pit vipers, and it's funny. In South Africa, a viper is called an adder. I know I've read like a lot of books, and like you see like the word adder and everything with that. Then we got to help treat some of the animals. There was like a black mamba that came in that had a laceration on its side, so we got to help clean the laceration out. Also, we got bit by a dog. I feel bad for the dog. I didn't make it. One of our friends, she got to pull an impacted fang from the black mamba, and a few other. I think what we did frontline. Some type of endoparasitic. Sorry, I can't talk. Oh, it was a green mamba. But yeah, it was really cool. Then we got to like practice picking up the snakes with the snake hooks and like, you know, moving them around. So if we ever had to come across that later on, we kind of have some tips in our pocket if we need to pick up a snake or, you know, remove it and relocate it.
So on another day, we had our crocodile lesson. These are crocodiles that they keep on the facility for their research and these kind of demonstrations. So we were actually involved in pulling the crocodile out of the water. And we assisted with like the capture and handling. We would also do sexing, blood draws, and immobilization of the different crocodiles.
So on this day, capture and relocation, we went to a privately owned game farm where there were giraffes. And I was in a different group from them. I don't think you guys captured the baby giraffe, but my group did because we wanted to prevent inbreeding. So we captured about 4 baby giraffes and moved them to another game farm down the street. And to be honest, we didn't really get to do much hands-on stuff this day, only because the sedative that they use doesn't completely anesthetize the giraffe. And if you're in the wrong place at the wrong time, you get kicked. Then it's really dangerous. But it's still cool to say that you're part of a giraffe capture. And I don't know what the thing is called that's connected to the truck, but the thing that you put the giraffe in, you can climb on top of it. And yeah, it's like a trailer thing. And as you drive to the main truck, your face is like right next to the giraffe's face. It's pretty cool.
Our group. So I guess we should have mentioned this at the beginning, but during our time there was an abnormally large number of students that wanted to go. So what they did is they split us up into 2 groups. Nancy and I were in one group, Walter was in another. So we got to go, I don't think you guys went to all of these. No, yeah, we got to go to a bunch of rehabilitation centers because weather was not permitting us to do capture and relocation. So I was really impressed with the wildlife vets people. They were able to make better use of our time. Instead of sitting inside while it was raining, we got to go to a couple more rehab centers. So these are the rehab centers that we went to and some pictures. I just wanted to make a note on this because I thought it was a great eye-opening experience as to the different levels of care that were provided to animals in the different rehab center. As we mentioned before, South Africa is not the most wealthy country, and so wildlife is not necessarily a top of the list priority for them. And so these rehab centers have been able to, you know, step in there and try and assist with animals that have been hit. You know, a lot of locals that might not necessarily have good relationships with the wildlife because it encroaches on their farm, destroys their property, and so these rehab centers are able to kind of amend that situation a little bit so these people have someone to call if they're having an issue. And then they also can't release some of the animals, so they have tourists and other people come in where they can educate, you know, school children and tourists about the animals and the situation to kind of make it more of a positive relationship.
We got to visit Kruger National Park. We had to wake up really early because we were at the park by the time the sun was rising, and it was a couple hour drive from where we were staying at. But it's definitely worth it, and we're there all day till about 4 or 5 o'clock. And we got to see all types of animals because basically you're spending the whole day driving around looking for animals. And our tour guide was really informative, and bouncing off of what Nancy was talking about the elephants, just learning about elephant conservation in Africa really makes me realize how complicated it is because you, so the cap for Kruger for elephants is about 7,000, and even at 7,000 elephants in the park, it's still more than what the habitat can hold. So they try different options such as culling elephants or giving out approved hunting permits. So people have to pay for these permits, and the money goes towards elephants, and also they can keep the number around 7,000. But once the general public sees these videos like on Facebook, and it could be viewed out of context. So really they didn't tell us that they have a solution for the issue. I don't know where I'm going with this, but basically it's a pretty complicated issue.
So I guess kind of backing up a sec, a huge problem is that Kruger National Park is the only land in South Africa that is government protected for wildlife. So this is the only spot of land where it's still wildlife, it's not controlled by a human being. So there's a problem of overpopulation with the elephants. And then once it became public that Kruger was doing these controlled cullings, it became a negative publicity for them, so they had to stop. And then now they're again dealing with the problem of overpopulation, where the elephants are just these huge animals, and everywhere we looked when we got to the park, there's down trees and like destroyed vegetation, which is making it more difficult for the other animals to live there. Did you have anything to add?
Garen also told us, I never knew this, but with the controlled culling, you know, what a lot of people got upset about was that they're killing babies, but the way elephants are, they're herd, they're very family oriented. You can't kill one, you have to kill the entire family, otherwise they're gonna mourn, and their quality of life severely diminishes. So I think that's also a big thing with culling elephants. And actually the ASPCA in the United States, I forget how long ago, in the 80s or 90s, they paid Kruger National Park and said, hey, we're gonna give you X millions of dollars to stop culling these elephants. You know, you can use that for better control, relocation, and whatnot. And Kruger said, hey, that sounds great. It was great at first, but then the ASPCA stopped funding them, but they were still they're still upheld to that contract. They signed a contract saying they would not call elephants. So the money ran out, they can't relocate these elephants, so they're kind of in a rock and a hard place. You know, there's no money to relocate them, but they're still bound to not call these elephants. So I think that's also a big problem that the media doesn't, you know, kind of highlight. So again, just the educational aspect of this trip, like I feel so much more well-informed. You know, I feel like I can confidently, you know, tell people about these issues, be like, hey, it's not as, you know, black and white as the media lets it believe it is.
But yeah, but they are, you know, exploring other options, as that is currently not an option for them, such as opening up one of the borders of the park to allow for further migration of the elephants. So regardless of your opinion, it was a great educational opportunity.
And just a little bit more on that, even with the hunting aspect of it, they can't hunt on Kruger, so they do open like a gate at some end of the park, and that became an issue too because they would go into the local community and then graze and browse on things they're not supposed to. But yeah.
So we had a couple different community days. One day we had to wake up at 3:30 in the morning and drive to the zone outside of Kruger. Kruger is full of disease, especially foot and mouth disease. And the way they control it is pretty interesting. We're not going to get into it, but they have like different zones based on like quarantine procedures. And so that morning we like went into one of these zones outside of Kruger, and we were vaccinating cattle for lumpy skin disease and checking for foot and mouth disease. So a lot of the local farmers, they'll come to these like different stocks, and that's where they're called veterinary technicians, but they're like kind of heads of certain parts of South Africa. There's like 12 districts, and like each district has a vet tech, which is like a head vet. So we go with that head vet to these different farms where the farmers can all congregate and check their cattle, vaccinate them, you know, do some basic care. So we got to do that. I think we went 2 days. It was the first day not a lot of farmers came. We did like over 400 head of cattle, something like that. And then another day, we went in and we did a rabies vaccine campaign for the local dogs. And this was a great like opportunity just to like practice restraining and handling, you know, a lot of these African dogs. They're not like dogs here, not even like St. Kitts. I think this is probably like what St. Kitts was before Ross came here. You know, the dogs, they are for one purpose, one person only, one purpose only, and it's to guard. You know, the owners have barely any contact with them. They're feeding them, you know, bones or whatever scraps from dinner they had that day. So they're not used to being handled by humans. So it was a great opportunity to practice handling on like more aggressive dogs and on how to, you know, get that vaccination in. And it was really like eye-opening and really cool because if you were with that head vet tech was also a part of this. And you know, the locals, you were a doctor to them. You know, if you were with that vet tech, they trusted you as a doctor. So, you know, they're asking for your advice. You know, what do I do about this? Oh, I found this on my dog. Like, what can I do about that? So it was like really cool to put everything that you're learning to use. I know we don't get like as much hands-on as we would like here. So it was really cool to be able to put everything we're learning to use and we feel like a super cool doctor. We also got to see a case of distemper, which was really, I mean, it was really sad, but it was cool to be able to, like, say, I have seen that, so now I could spot it again if I saw it. But this poor dog was, like, shaking, you know, it had the crusty eyes and, like, face. You want to say it? Kane, one of the wildlife vets that, like, runs the course, he told us this interesting fact about African dogs specifically, so I'll let Katie tell you that because she thought it was the coolest thing ever.
Apparently, because distemper is more widespread in South Africa, they have an innate immunity, so they have a 50-50 chance of survival. So it wasn't completely sad.
Yeah, whereas like distemper, it's like you basically euthanize your dog because there's no chance of survival in the States in here. Oh, and then, this is not on the like usual schedule, but one of the kids in our group, he graduated like in biology and chemistry major, and he's like really into the pharmaceutical aspects. And he said, "Hey, you know, do you ever give tours of your pharmaceutical facility?" And they said, "Let us check." And they actually let us. They took a couple people. It wasn't the whole group. I was one of the people that got to go and tour their pharmaceutical industry, their facility, and we got to see everything from like how they start to make the drugs, how they package it and like ship it. It was really cool because like we're seeing it from like start to end, how we make it all the way to like how it gets used out in the field, because those were the drugs that we were doing drug trials on, and then those are the drugs that we were using for like capture and relocation day, like on those giraffes. So it was really cool to like see it go from start to finish. So if that's something you're interested in, they can definitely make that happen for you. You know, a lot of the stuff that we did, it was like, on, like, can we do this? Like, do you think we can? Spend the time to, you know, do that. And wildlife vets, they were very accommodating. They did everything they could to, you know, try to get as much experience in whatever you were interested in.
So this day we went to a place called Cradle of Life, where there were different fenced areas with different breeds of lions, lionesses, and tigers. And this one, in the top right photo, you can see there's four cubs, and then there's two cages. The mom and dad are separated. And then in this middle picture, you can see the vet is watching for the mom. Yes, Soka. She's a great vet. But the mom is on the left picture. We inserted a contraceptive before they were relocated to a bigger fenced area. They just didn't want her to be breeding anymore. And also we collected fecal samples of the cubs just to check for anything detrimental like parasites. And finally, we went to Elephant Whispers, which is an elephant sanctuary. They currently have 6 rescued elephants, the oldest one being Tembo. You can see them, they're all lined up together, and They put up a little show. They did tricks for us. And it's really interesting. They told us that elephants are able to learn over 100 verbal commands. And yeah, it's a really educational visit, not just for us vet students, but also for the guests. So I think it's a really good place.
And also on that note, the elephant whisperers, they only use positive reinforcement on their elephants. So if an elephant doesn't want to come to work that day, it does not have to. You learned some fun Afrikaans lingo, as our hosts were Afrikaans. And then that's it. Does anyone have any questions? Yeah.
So I know that there's multiple companies that go to South Africa. Why would you choose this one over the other?
Really? I chose Wildlife at South Africa. I kind of like got Katie and a bunch of my friends to join. I knew someone who went with them, and they did a Ross talk like this after their experience. I think they did it through Zoo Club. But it just, I've always wanted to go to Africa. It's on my bucket list, and I said, hey, why not? You know, and after going to the lecture, I don't know if anyone knows Matt Marquis. He was in Old Blue, but he was the one that I talked to. I was just very interested. I liked the company, you know, I just liked what I heard and how there's so much you can do. Because it's South Africa, so there's less laws, and you can like practice medicine under those vets, like licenses. I mean, I've heard good things about all the companies. I just really like Wildlife Vet South Africa because they seem very accommodating. You know, if something went wrong, because all this stuff, they only do it in their winter time, which is our summer, because it gets too hot during their summertime to like capture and relocate. And so, like, you know, a lot of these schedules, they're very tentative because, you know, weather permitting, everything changes. So they had backup plan after backup plan. You know, they didn't expect to take, I think there's like 24 students in our group, and they managed to take 24 students and split us into two separate groups. And with all of that planning and stuff, they were able to still give us a great time. Both groups got to do almost the exact same thing. We had to leave a little bit early, so some of the groups, I think they became like one smaller group after some of the students left. And they got to go capture and relocate some elephants and stuff. So, you know, you're going to see a lot. And what Matt said is, you know, no matter what semester you're in, you know, you're going to get something out of the experience. Like, I wanted to go this August break specifically because I had just finished fifth semester when you take anesthesia, so I thought it'd probably be a lot easier to apply what I learned in anesthesia and, like, know what the monitoring equipment is, since a lot of what you're doing is sedation and tranquilization. So I like that aspect, and that's why I chose the August break. But again, Walter could probably agree to see the semester behind me. But you're going to get so much out of it, you know, depending on what you put into it. They're going to make sure that you learn something and that you want to come back and that you feel comfortable with conservation of any species. It doesn't have to be the African species. So that's why I chose them.
For me, I'm happy that I chose them after the fact. Nancy kind of roped me into it. But after the fact, I'm very happy I chose this company because I did notice that every step of the way, they're thinking about the animals. How can we best care for them, given the means, given our job? Like, I have a little bit of a controversial view about the whole game capture now, afterwards, but I do feel like every step of the way, it was, you know, what they do, and they put focus on the animals. Like, yes, they wanted to give us experience, but it's like, you could tell they had the animals' best interests at heart for everything, every step of the way.
Yeah, just real quickly. I went to Africa after my fourth semester, so I didn't take anesthesia yet, but the lectures were still helpful, and I was able to get things from them. And then going into the fifth semester, which is this semester, I feel like anesthesia, I wouldn't say anesthesia was a breeze, but it did some of the drugs, like, you've heard them before, you've used them before, so it's cool to say, like, oh, I remember using Atomidate in Africa, they also give us a course pack on the first day, they break down the lectures, who teaches them, and what's taught, so even if you're having a rough morning that day, you can always review back your course packet.
Any other questions?
For, like, the local dogs that you want to go treat, sounds kind of like trips every year. like, how is accessibility for playing to productions up for?
So with us, we had, I believe it was Frontline Spray. So most of the people that we went and saw, we drove up and we were split into groups of three or four, and we had different stations set up throughout a local district. And so, you know, people don't have cars, and so they have to walk their dogs to see us. Where we were able to give them a full physical exam. If we noticed that they had fleas and ticks, we would treat them with a Frontline Spray. We did not have any flea and tick preventative to hand out to people. We did hand out like leashes and collars, and treated whatever we could with what we had. This was all funded by the company that we were working with, except for the rabies vaccine, which was provided by the local government.
Yes, and we should say, probably like Vita, this is, what we did was not gold standard care. Like, we were reusing needles and stuff just because, you know, wildlife vets, they get donations or it's money they can set aside from their practice to buy these stuff. So, you know, we don't know how many dogs would come in. It could be 100 to 1,000 dogs. So, you know, you just have to work with the supplies you get, and you work with, you know, the most prevalent things. So we had the Frontline Spray because mangleworms are a big issue in South Africa, and it mostly affects their ears. Mange was a big concern, so if you saw mange, we were able to have a couple ivermectin shots, and you just kind of use what you can and make it last as long as you can to help as many dogs. And these dogs, it's made more of how much can you do before they get too mad or before they're unworkable. So it's just more do what you can and hope for the best type of situation. A lot of dogs, they came in really bad shape, and they're like, oh, they're going to, like, make it right, and they're like, no, but, you know, here's what you can do to keep them comfortable, you know, hopefully this will work. And with the leashes, Garen and Michelle, they bought those leashes on their own. He was telling us that he started that about 2 years ago, and he said last year was, like, the first time he saw one of his leashes come back, because a lot of these dogs, like, it's, what is it called, a hanger, like, hanger wires for your clothes, like, those were their leashes or their collars. So he was like, no, like, you need to, like, try to educate the community, make them better. So he started the collars and leashes, just like Velcro leashes and collars. And he's starting to see that more locals are starting to use it. So it's kind of a cool thing to see. He said that, like, the locals are, you know, learning slowly but gradually. Yeah, I don't know where else I was going with that. I'm really tired. Sorry.
So Sam and Mandy over there also went on the trip with us. So rabies was a huge deal in South Africa. Like, we were talking with the vet assistant, and he told us about, like, cases of children being hit by dogs and getting rabies. And then there's, you know, no real treatment for it, especially in South Africa. But after implementing this government rabies program that we were assisting with, they, you know, maybe get one or two cases a year of rabies in people, whereas before it was a lot more prevalent. Did that answer your question? Just out of curiosity, is anybody here thinking of going to tap? Okay. Very cool. If you guys have any questions or anything, you guys can always contact us, Facebook, email.
Yeah, on that, Michelle gave me a whole bunch of information, so if you guys, like, want that stuff, just give me your email or message me on Facebook and I can send it to you guys. She's told me, I'm not sure about the April trip, but this upcoming August trip of 2018, she said she's only taking 15 people. I think the 24 of us overwhelmed her, so I don't think she's ever going to do another group that big again. So if you are interested, if you know friends who are interested, just let them know that there's not going to be as many spots as this past August week. Excuse me. This past August break, and I am your point of contact, so I can give you Michelle's email. I know her email right now is not working, so if you have already emailed them and you haven't gotten a response, that's why. I think she got hacked or something, but I have a separate email if anyone is interested or wants more information. Other than that, thank you guys for coming. We enjoyed it. We hope we convince you guys to go or to get, you know, more into conservation medicine somehow. Thank you.
Lindley, you're talking. Yeah. You're talking today.
What?
Just like,